welcome for our guests from many countries. We are a true international conference, guests from Serbia, from Estonia, from USA, naturally. Welcome. And now we start another point, which is the presentation of the team which organized this conference. It is a woman archive which started with a grant and will develop more and more, and maybe will start to be something like Legends Archive. I can introduce our speakers. It will be Kasia Nadana-Sokołowska, Eva Serafin-Prusator, Emilia Kolinko, which come already, and Monika Rudaś-Grodzka. So, go ahead.
I'm first.
Yeah.
And I'd like to read the kind of our manifesto. Our digital women's archive, which we call Writing Women, includes unpublished manuscripts written by women living in the area of historical Poland from 16th century to our days. Our database is composed of manuscripts which have been found during queries and research in different archives in Poland, Lithuania, Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia. Archival queries, as you know, are the first step of our work, but they should have an exceptional and essential status. You can ask why. The moment of taking written papers into our hands is a turning point. It doesn't matter if it's in a court report or memoirs with a signature from the traditional catalog or a lost letter found by accident. The moment of touching of pale yellow paper is an existential experience of the presence of the dead. The experience takes place on the frontier of a sacred space, but it doesn't belong to any religion. Our Polish poet Adam Mickiewicz described calling up spirit in the Dziady, part 2, Forefathers' Eve. The communion with the dead became part of our imagination in Polish culture. In a boring, quiet place, which is far from the sublime holiness or attractiveness, we bent over faded pages and performed the ritual of forefathers or rather foremothers. We meet with the silent women and this contact completes their suddenly broken life. Their voices didn't solve the end. Their life was too short or too tragic to be considered fulfilled. Phantoms of these women wandered among dreams, thoughts, the memories written down in the diaries and letters as they wait for salvation. We find their traces, photos, locks of hair, ribbons, which are for us signs of a disagreement to irrevocable passing away. Material objects and immaterial thoughts written down on paper designate a special space which is called limbo. And by crossing the threshold, we can come closer and hear their voices. We perform the ritual of foremothers or fathers because our duty imposes it on us as those who were to come later. Georges Michelet, Mickiewicz's friend, believed that the past is alive in archive and the ink can speak. In the preface of his History of France, Michelet confessed that he was shocked when he was walking down the empty corridors of archive. He was haunted by suffering souls from the past, waiting for liberation. He understood his mission was to rescue unknown shadows from the past. In the recesses of the archives, the French historian became a witness and observer of the performance of the dead. For them, a great misery is not death, but unfinished life. Michelet saw himself as a person who appeased phantoms and exorcised their fears and anxieties from old days and discovered meaning in their life. Michelet and later Walter Benjamin, thought that our existence is unhappy, miserable and unclosed. Unfulfillment will come in the future. We are needed because we are weak messiahs. We bring liberation to the forgotten past. If we don't understand this mission, the phantoms will be doomed to wander among us. We have to understand the phantoms of women don't belong only to past centuries, which marginalized them, ignored them, neglected, disdained them, but also belong to our days. Our awareness of this oppression forced us to act on their behalf. Our work of memory somewhat resembles exhumation. If thanks to digging the past out of the grave and carrying to the present, our community of dead and living is confirmed. At the beginning of a historian work, to search for truth is not important. According to Benjamin, the goal is to do justice to the person whose life is in our hands. First, we must notice our recklessness and blindness. We live in the place of others who passed away. We breathe the same air, we touch the same object. Sometimes we have the impression that we can discern something gone without shape. Unfortunately, this picture of the past escapes us. In order to do the task and do justice to the dead, we need to get rid of our habitual way of thinking and forget about the idea of progress and linear time. It's then that we will admit that the homogeneous and continuous picture of empty time is only a construction of our mind, serving the dominant narratives, and if we understand it, we will see unclosed events. In the archive, we see that every event has got a face and unfinished story. When we sit at the desk, it's something strange happens. We see how the past complements the present. Benjamin wrote that the present is a roller film on which the past appears and disappears, which weave the clothes in the folder. We are accompanied by melancholy, but we can't let our gloom spoil our meeting with the past, which comes to us in one short flash of remembering. For Michelet, the important part was the resurrection of the dead. For Benjamin, it was the redemption of victims of oppressive history. We must agree with him. Usually they belong to the lowest class and we didn't have the chance to speak out for themselves. We must remember that for centuries women have been victims of our history. Benjamin didn't refer to women in his article on the concept of history. But now we should include women in the messianic discourse of emancipation of the defeated. At the end of his life, Benjamin was interested in history. He thought that the work of historian is a messianic task. He drew his inspiration from Marxist philosophy and Jewish religion, but he used the category of nostalgia as a revolutionary method for criticizing his contemporaries. But the key category is remembrance and redemption. The redemption of the past is reparation and completion of dreams and wishes which remain unfinished in the past. We must say that there is no redemption without women. There is no liberation if we forget about the suffering souls of women. We protest on their behalf against the oppression of history which condemned them to non-existent and silence. The messianic force is not contemplative gaze into past, but revolutionary task in the present. We are expected on earth, and we are to rescue the dead from oblivion. We are continued with our fight for emancipation. All women without distinction for greater, more famous, and less known, and ordinary persons deserve our remembrance and attention. Our care about women obliges us to fight against traditional history. Following Benjamin, we must question every victory because every victory has violence and injustice and deprives the defeated and victims of opportunity to speak out loud. We are here to help them, and our duty is to criticize victorious discourses which cast women aside.
It's my I will present the project Women's Archives, which has been carried out since 2013 under the leadership of Professor Monika Rudaś-Grodzka. The project is performed as a part of the grant of the National Program for the Development of Humanities of the Ministry of Science and Higher Education in Poland. Our project is inspired by similar archival projects since 1980s carried out in many Western countries, among others in the United States or in Poland. The project aims to create a database and launch a digital archive of unpublished life writing written by women who lived in the territories of historic Poland since the 16th century to the present. The database resulting from the project will include women's manuscripts traced down on the basis of research in various archives in contemporary Poland and other European countries, with a particular emphasis on the areas associated with Polish culture through their status as its former territories, parts of Lithuania, Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia. The manuscripts in the online catalog are indexed according to criteria essential for future analysis of their content, such as authorship, place and time of origin, literary, genre. The record is a unique, extensive bibliographical description of the manuscript. Records include the basic bibliographical description based on Dublin Core Standard and extended data description like bibliographical questionnaire of the author, consisting of over 20 categories, among them social origin, religious identity, class identity, type of Finnish school. The questionnaire of the manuscript contains deepened historical context, etc., a description of the document. It problematizes its content, gives deepened historical context. Questionnaire also provides keywords related to such fields of humanities as history, including history of customs and history of ideas, anthropology, sociology, political science, pedagogy, cultural studies, literary studies, etc. The catalog, which is now available only to members of the project team, will serve as the basis for a digital archive, which will be developed in the future, in 2018, as a website accessible to anyone. The scholars working on the project specialize in gender studies, in particular in the study of literature created by women of various historical periods, such as early modernity, romanticism, second half of the 19th century, or modernism. They specialize in various genres and aspects of women's writing, including diaries and letters, autobiographies, family chronicles and sagas, silverarum or convent writings, or in links between Polish and Eastern European cultures or Polish and Jewish culture. The team members independently choose archives and old written texts basing on their research interests and research intuition as regards documents which may appear the most interesting for contemporary readers. The project team Women's Archives comprises approximately 15 permanent employees. The team is diversified in terms of generations and professions. The members of the team are experienced scholars, young academics, as well as PhD students, employees of libraries, archives, and museums. This allows knowledge to be transferred between people of different generations. Experiences can be exchanged, values and attitudes can be transferred. What made us decide to carry out this project? First of all, we wanted to retain various documents written by women, which are a record of ephemeral feelings and thoughts or trivial events doomed to oblivion. Women's diaries, memoirs, correspondence, and unpublished manuscripts of their literary works, especially from before the second half of the 19th century, are still a barely known continent of Polish culture. Life writings hold secrets of women's identity and origins of this identity, as well as secrets of women's relationships and activities other than those considered to be the only significant ones for a women's biography. Diaries and letters by women are a fascinating source of research on female morals, for example, on the character of ties which link them and the role they play in each other's lives. Such cultural threads are neglected and put on the sidelines of official culture, in which a woman plays the role only through reference to a man, a father, a husband, a son. It was essential to us that the writing self of woman could have enough space to speak, to show in which dialogue relations it is and how it shapes the identities of persons involved in this dialogue. At the end of the year 2016, the database consisted of about 2,000 records. Among the records, there are diaries written for children, diaries written for the family, young girls' diaries, memoirs, journals, silver rerum, sketchbooks, reports on historical events, correspondence. The records entered in the database so far are arranged in the following thematic sections of the archive. Section number one, documents relating to the Second World War. The records concern the documents collected by the Central Jewish Historical Commission and the Central Committee of Polish Jews, intended to document the history of Jews during the Second World War. Also, records concern diaries of the Second World War, the occupation, time spent in the ghettos, hiding at the Aryan site, forced labor, extermination and persecution, which affected the Jews and Polish people. Some accounts extensively describe the history of the authors and their families. Other are brief pieces of information which were supposed to be developed or used as basis for drawing up indictments for post-war processes. The records include the reports on survivors in the prisoner of war camps, concentration camps and gulags, life in occupied Warsaw, in particular during the Warsaw Uprising, and memoirs of the Polish emigration in London during the Battle of Britain. An important group of texts are the accounts of forced deportation to Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan in February and April 1914. The records of this section include many recollections which may be a basis for research on women's experience of the extermination, from the experience of daily life in occupied Poland, through the experience of maternity, loneliness, and also violence and death of close friends and family. Also, these records draw a picture of diversity of war experiences depending on the place of residence as well as social and class position of the author of memoirs. The second group of documents are works entered by women in literary historical competitions. The scope of this area consists of the memoirs of the extermination and its reception both by women of Polish and Jewish identity, regardless of whether this identity was imposed upon them or not, and works entered in the literary contest of the interwar period. In the archives of the State Museum at Majdanek, the collection containing works entered in the competition of camp recollections for former male and female prisoners was found. This collection contains various literary forms, from poetry created as early as in the camp, through short statements almost free of emotions, to long memoirs depicting life of the camp almost day after day. On the basis of such memoirs, we can reconstruct the social structure and hierarchies established between its layers. However, due to the subject matter and the context, this material is very difficult to elaborate, and the very work is in the archive situated at the camp is a challenge. An especially interesting element of this group, of the second group, are the memoirs of women living in small towns and villages. Therefore, in the collection, we can find also accounts prepared by illiterate women who had an opportunity to present indirect reports written by a third party. Next group of documents are documents relating to life of women of land-owning families linked with Greater Poland and with the emigration, socially active and politically involved in the 19th century. Selected publications show their achievements, views, opinions, beliefs and ideas, but also their attitudes and emotions presented in letters to close friends and family, diaries, memoirs. The third group of documents are documents relating to internal lives of women. Records include, among others, the correspondence of religious character by Mother Urszula Leduchowska, the founder of the Congregation of the Ursulines of the Agonizing Heart of Jesus, to Maria Leokadia Sternicka-Dejmeyer of the years 1921-1937. In this group of documents, we also can find the diaries of the retreat by Emilia Wróblewska, an education and social activist. These diaries document Wróblewska's religious thoughts and show her spiritual and religious commitments. The last group of documents are letters and diaries of women involved in left-wing activities before the Second World War and after the war. These records contain, above all, a large collection of letters by Wanda Wasilewska to her relatives and friends, letters and memoirs about Melania Kierczyńska, and letters by Janina Broniewska.
The most interesting discoveries found during archival research conducted by the team of Women's Archives include, for example, the diary by Hanna Nowkowska-Bikowa, kept in the Polish National Library, or memoirs by Wanda Gojawiczewska, memoirs of evacuation with her mother and Zofia Nowkowska, or diaries by Grażyna Macewicz. Nowkowska-Bikowa was a known sculptor during the interwar period and at the same time the sister of one of the best Polish women writers, Zofia Nowkowska. Nowkowska-Bikowa is now almost forgotten as an artist, while her sister's prose is still being read and recognized. Diaries by Nowkowska, written for over half a century, are one of the most outstanding examples of women's life writing in Polish literature. A particularly interesting part of those diaries was written during World War II. Unknown diaries of Hanna Nowkowska-Bikowa from the period of World War II constitute a hidden dialogue with Zofia Nowkowska's diaries. Hanna Bikowa hid her diary from her sister, even though they appeared to have good, close contact with each other. She didn't want to show her despair after their mother's death, which resulted in her deep depression. At the same time, mourning the mother was an important motive in Zofia Nowkowska's diary. Based on Nowkowska's diary, we can say she considered herself a guardian of her younger, mentally weaker sister. For example, she kept in secret the death of Bikowa's husband. Based on Bikowa's diary, we can realize that she was aware of the role her sister tried to play and didn't fully agree with her role of a weaker sister. Nowkowska had tried to impose on her, but because of gender feeling for her sister, she wanted to avoid any open conflict. An interesting complement to accounts known, for instance, from war diaries of Zofia Nowkowska are memoirs of evacuation with my mother and Zofia Nowkowska by Wanda Gojawiczyńska-Nadzinowa, who was the daughter of Pola Gojawiczyńska, a writer. The document is a description of evacuation from Warsaw and the reflections, emotions and concerns of Wanda Gojawiczyńska-Nadzinowa associated with it. Here, the author's agency and independence are revealed, as it was her who gave an impetus to an attempt to evacuate. Gojawiczyńska-Nadzinowa often focuses on the figure of Zofia Naukowska. An important element of memories is her attitude to Naukowska, which was initially cool and distant. The author was irritated with Naukowska's wardrobe, her dressing case full of cosmetics and accessories, and her astonishment that both mother and daughter had not taken evening dresses with them. But later, Wanda Gojawiczyńska-Nadzinowa noticed self-control and energy of Madame Zofia, and she grew fond of her and started to respect her. A turning point of this relationship was the situation when they got stuck at the edge of the dense crowd of disarmed Polish soldiers who were going to Lublin. Then Naukowska found a visit card of Jurko Rzechowska, wife of General, in her dressing case, which enabled the group to cross the way. It was then when Gojawiczyńska-Nadzinowa began to admire Naukowska's agility and also her fast acting and thinking, which she associated with a divine Olympian calm. The diary of the renowned Polish composer and violinist Grażyna Bacewicz is different from these diaries and memoirs. The text encompasses the years 1954-1956, showing the composer's personality unknown to the public and researchers, as she continually struggled with their own complexes and the opposition of musical circles. The diary has a character of personal and irregular notes, which consists of private reflections on current cultural events, family matters, social life, professional activities of the composer, and her views on the arts. The date of the first entry was on the composer's 45th birthday. Therefore, keeping a journal had the symbolic dimension for her and was a form of autotherapy. The most important and frequently appearing theme in the diary is the problem of artistic creation. It concerns mainly writing music by the author herself, but there are also other problems related to this issue in the description of the first attempts of painting made by her daughter, Alina Biernacka. Bacewicz did not evade writing about the relationship with her daughter. The moments spent with her are a ritual necessary for Bacewicz to feel well. In this relationship with her daughter, the composer seems to find not only satisfaction, but also emotional self-sufficiency. In the correspondence found during archival research, the ties established by women among themselves mainly attracted attention. Often beyond the patriarchal society, when they were unnoticed and were able to build entire women's communities. The most interesting examples of this type of correspondence are letters written by real and symbolic schoolgirls of Narcyza Żmichowska, a romantic Polish writer. Here we should mention the collections of letters by Wanda Umińska to Emilia Wróblewska, or the saved two-page correspondence by Izabela Zbigniewska and her female pupil and later friend Stanisława Kalińska. In this correspondence, on the one hand, we can find marks of political and social activities of women, now often forgotten. On the other hand, the support is visible. Women supported each other in different areas of life in the patriarchal world, where there was no room for them, for their activities and relationships between women. Thus, the project allows us to follow the women's continuum, emotional bonds between women on the basis of family membership, friendship or intimate love, which has been virtually erased from the collective memory by the official historiographical and national discourse, separating the current generations from a full knowledge of the customs and culture of women of earlier times. It seems to us that the importance of the project Archives of Women cannot be overstated. The database, searchable by multiple criteria, including thematic criteria, and including information on existing manuscripts by women, will be helpful to all scholars interested in the history of literature, cultural history, cultural anthropology, as well as gender issues in Poland and related territories. A few months ago, we applied to the Ministry of Science and Higher Education in Poland for the continuation of the project, but we still search for funds to continue the project and to develop it, especially because the funding offered by the ministry is insufficient to meet the goals of our project. We would like, among other objectives, extend the database by at least 1,500 more records. Records will be done according to standards we developed through queries performed in Polish and Central European archives. Furthermore, we would like to publish the most valuable manuscripts online and in hard copy form, and make a modern multi-layer platform for digital edition of the selected manuscripts. Also, we plan to create at least 3 digital exhibitions related to the project. We are convinced that it is crucial to translate the database into foreign languages, first to English, later to other languages, for example, German, Russian or French. Last but not least of our goals is to create a global network for the exchange of information on women's writing with other projects of that type. The project is now summed up with our conference.
So I'm going to finish our presentation with the convention and revolution context. As Girls said, in the women's archive, we collect unknown manuscripts, letters, diaries and memoirs which were written by women. We try to reconstruct their biographies, looking for direct and indirect links between the authors. We create constellations of influence. They let us realize that these autobiographical practices, which are often underestimated, marginalized by scholars or mentioned selectively, were inherited by the authors from their mothers and later passed on to their daughters. The author's autobiographical discourse was limited to their closest family and social circles. Their autobiographical practices were a dynamic, varied and indispensable movement in the history of women's writing, women's art and women's self-expression. The fact that these personal documents were known only to a limited community does not reduce their revolutionary potential. Primarily, these are letters and diaries, dated traces of existence in which retrospection, recapitulation and opinion were constrained or suspended. The diaries and letters were rooted in daily activities. They accompanied small and large revolutions in a woman's life. We are interested in these private revolutions, which were hidden under the mask of genre conventions, concealment, repetitive matter, as well as the cultural and personal limitations of expressing oneself. The correspondence of Anna Muszyńska is a record of such a private breakthrough. This is an almost unknown figure. Born in 1920, she belonged to the generation of the so-called Amazons, women who were teachers, writers, conspirators. On the one hand, it was a generation of active, gifted, independent enthusiasts, the women who belonged to the circle of Nadana-Sokołowska. Muszyńska, despite her wishes, was never able to take part in such activities. On the other hand, this generation was raised according to the pattern advocated by Klementyna Hoffmanowa. And I'm going to cite a part from the reminder of a good mother. From the text, I'm sorry, of Grażyna Barkowska. A young Polish woman brought up according to the model drawn from the reminder of a good mother was a quiet, pious woman who possessed a meager intellectual ability and a modest set of social rights and obligations. It was always and often stressed that she was inferior towards her husband. Young Polish women were supposed to express themselves in housework, bringing up children and caring for the husband. Anna Muszyńska's letters to her husband and children portray the tension between the desire of activity and imposed passivity, between the sense of power and helplessness. The author seamlessly adapts to the role of a mother. But as the wife of Piotr Moszyński, a much older political activist and philanthropist who was exiled to Siberia, she once attempts to gain freedom and independence, only to return to her submission and to accept the limitations of her social role. And in the end, she accepts silence. Her dream of change, intertwined with obedience to the requests of her husband, expressed itself in special circumstances during her stay in a psychiatric hospital in Pirna and Lobus, where she was rushed for the first time in 1950 and where she stayed for 20 years, more than 20 years. The letters to her to husband and children, with whom Moszyńska was keeping in contact for more than 20 years of separation, is a very diverse material, difficult to interpret and involving various literary genres. The author placed in her letters drawings, poems, children's tales, which she herself wrote. This variety, however, harmonizes with a feminist perspective, which considers Moszyńska as not only a victim of a patriarchal social relations, but also as a woman conscious of her subjectivity. Her own self took shape in a time of complete isolation, thanks to the medium of letters, which were not used for communication, basically. A room in the psychiatric hospital where she was able to write became for a short time the room of her own. The edition of the letters of Moszyńska, which we are preparing in our archive, will be the first 19th century testimony of a woman who stayed in a mental institution. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this presentation. I propose now to describe a little bit more personal, your access to archives, your experience, and your idea.
Monika, in the archive, have you found something very important, and why did you come to the project like this? Because the team was working some years, and I remember very good the moment when we started this project. It is not all what we do, because we have edited, and you didn't mention it, some books. There is books, kind of gender encyclopedia. It was very important project of this team, the encyclopedia of gender. Which year was 2013, something like this. I'm very sorry that we can't see this book. Maybe it will be useful to bring it tomorrow or at the break. And the Encyclopedia of Gender was first so complex presentation of this field of interest in humanities, and it came from about literature, about social theory. Critical access, philosophy, what else? Biology, also. History, economy. Yes, we have a specialist for a feminist approach to economy. This Encyclopedia of Gender give for a reader very good and very complex access
quick access to the field of interest. So it was Encyclopedia of Gender. The second one project of the team was 44. It was a kind of dictionary of women heroes in Polish literature. Could you finish? Could you describe this?
Yes, 44 is very symbolic because it's the it refers to Adam Mickiewicz's forefathers, and 44 symbolize hero, messianic heroes who liberate us. And for us, Salvador is the meaning. And it was the idea for us. But my personal experience is very easy because I prefer dead than life and I'm historian. And I feel better in archives and books when interaction with people who live and it's easy. But I the gender is
it is not true. Monika is a very excellent leadership of the team. And it is Monika's work, a very big challenge. Yes?
No. It depends on a very young team. And without girls, we have nothing. And it's very important because we are old.
Yes, I am the oldest part of the team, professor, and I am a little bit apart because it's only a part of my work. But it is very big opportunity to be with younger researcher and people so devoted personally for finding documents for build this archive. I'm very sorry that you can't show how it is work. There is Dominik Urhawa names. He is informatician.
He's a genius
of informatician, yes, and he helped us to build this archive, which will be digital.
Yes.
Eva.
Okay, so he knows all these details about how we will do it technical, and now we are working to demonstrate the database, but I don't want to spoil it, so I won't show it right now, but it is very important for us to make many categories by which we can search a database. And for example, the one of the category is relations, and we will have diagrams which will show relations of author with other persons. And what is very important, many of these relations, we didn't know about them before starting this project.
and it can be a great opportunity for later research.
Please.
Kasia?
So, I may only add that I am a diarist, and I love to read diaries. I have written my MA thesis on a diary of a famous Polish painter Józef Czapski, and then I have written my PhD dissertation on Polish philosophers who dealt with the problem of religion in their mm-hmm. diaries. And finally, when I realized that feminist critics is something what interests, what is the most interesting part of humanist research for me, I started to work with women diaries and women autobiographies. And I am I am happy that in our project, I can work with things which I really like to read. Now I am working on the diary of Adela Kiniewicz, which was found during our queries, and I will speak about this diary on Friday. We have found 38 volumes of this diary in the Kyiv's archives in Ukraine.
Thank you. You asked about our experience in reading manuscripts. I will say just a few words because I'm better at not talking, silent and sitting in the archives and so on. So I started working with manuscripts of personal documents written by women 7 years ago. So it was before I joined to the team of our women archive here. And it was, I found in the library of our university a diary written by a wife of a general from 19th century. It was written just after the uprising of 1940 in Poland. And I was after years of reading literature, books, I was studying Polish philology. I found a document which was exceptional, which was about life and children, about ill children, and about just this all daily efforts. And I didn't know what to do with that diary. So after 2 years, I started to read a lot of articles of Legend, of Cynthia Huff, of Sidonie Smith, and I decided to start my personal and a little bit academic search for journals and basically journals, diaries from 19th century in their archives, because in Poland we still don't have many editions of 19th century diaries written by women. But we have a lot of manuscripts in the archives. So my personal, I found after 7 years, I have about 100 of diaries from 19th century only in manuscripts, and to compare. We have just 20 editions of such diaries in Polish. We have a lot to do, in this area. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I open the discussion. Please ask. Please comment. grateful for advice, for questions. Yeah?
Excuse me, thank you so much for the overview of the project and also for your observations about your investments in it. I just have a couple questions that are conceptual questions about the project, because I wondered if there was if you had any conversations of doing the Polish diaspora. And I'm thinking of all the immigrant documents that are available in the United States, both in the late 19th century and over the 20th century. And I just wondered if there was talk about kind of expanding the notion of Polonia to the diaspora. That's one thing. And then with relationship to testimonies and witnessing of women who may have been writing at the time of the Holocaust, I wondered if there was any talk about collecting narratives by children of survivors or non-survivors that may also be in the diaspora. So there's a kind of Marianne Hirsch's term of post-memory generation of people. So that, those are just conceptual questions.
Yeah. Monika? No.
Who would you like to make the map of diaspora?
We would like to make much more queries that we have, but our grant, yes, it is a grant, and it is finished in 2018. And but we would like to, and we hope that our project will get financed by ministry or other high ministry or something like that, and we will continue it. And of course, we are a small team.
Yes.
We are a small team. So in our project, I think there were about 50 persons maximum. So, and for example, they worked in the first year of the project. After that, they do their stuff. They stuff. So, it is also our problem to, because we are small team. So, not every manuscripts we can read. But of course, it is our dream. And about reports. Holocaust. Well, here is Natalia Jinska, and she made queries in Majdanek, and also in others in other archives. And maybe I will. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Just like to answer very short on your second question. I was responsible for making work in the Jewish Historical Institute, and we collected with Anna Rosner, who is also like who is a worker of Jewish Historical Institute. We collected testimonies and memoirs not only of the women but of young women, so of their children as well.
Yes.
Because after the Second World War, many of the survivors were children. So
yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. First off, I'd like to thank you for your work on this archive, which I think is really important in the way that it can relate to our other similar archives internationally. I apologize if I missed this in what you said, but has there been an effort with what Philippe Lejeune was talking about, for example, to find archives via flea markets, via advertisements, et cetera? In other words, letters and diaries that aren't in official archives. archives now.
Once again, we have thought about it and we are going to try to do it. We don't have enough place to make a real archive
space in our
institute to do such an our archives. So we deal with public archives or family archives, and we digitalize our foundings. Yeah.
Yeah. Space is usually.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I have some letters you might be interested in. So my presentation is about these letters. So maybe we can talk about that later. Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. My name is Tina Lindman, and actually my question relates to what you asked about, but from a bit different angle. I was thinking about when you were presenting this wonderful project that, I'm quite sure you have thought about that, but you just didn't say that, how are you going to speak to the larger audience? And then it connects to what you said about the secret archives, so to say, that how people would there, have you, or is there a possibility for the larger audience to kind of deliver there what they have? In Finland, we have a similar case. In many families, there are huge amounts of wartime letters from the Second World War, and it's a treasure nowadays. And people just don't know where to put them because archives don't take them nowadays. But so that was my question. More generally, how are you going to speak to the larger audience, and as part of that, how to kind of collect their materials?
So I think that
microphone.
Our idea to solve that problem is to propose those people to digitalize these documents, perhaps, and then we may put them in the internet and to enjoy them, because
yes, it is our first thought, but we think about how to resolve this problem. And who will do it?
Yeah.
If I could just follow up, I'm interested in some of the very material struggles you had with this important and foundational kind of project of women's writing in Poland. What do you do about transcribing the letters? I'm working on a project too where many of the original handwritten materials, you know, they're fading, they're almost unreadable. And getting them transcribed, questions of copyright if they're owned by families, and of course copyright laws differ from country to country, but even for digital publication this is an issue. And then perhaps another stage is a collection that can be published by a university press here, which, because let's face it, another part of the labor is whether the universities you work with value and credit this kind of research and publication. As we know, that can also be an issue in conservative academies. So the material issues are also a question.
So copyright
and books. Monika, comment. Eva.
Emilia.
We are
publishing two books.
No. Yes, because we, as I said, we have a big problem in Poland in publishing personal documents written by women, because these documents are underestimated. In the scholar world. So here in our team, we've just started a project of publishing these documents. We are going to publish letters from 1986. These letters were written by Prinsesa Walikurska, which was a member of the socialist movement at the end of the 19th century, and I am going to publish all letters by Anna Oshinska, as I said in my presentation. What is the problem? Just money and time and people who are interested enough in this very effortive work of transcribing and so on. In Poland, you've asked about, excuse me,
copyright.
About authors' copyrights, in Poland we have this limit of 70 years. After 70 years,
it's international.
Oh, it's international. Just sorry, I'm not good at that. Okay, so but we have. I'm especially interested in 19th century, so I don't have any problems in publishing.
Yes, but in our team is also a lawyer.
And there is so many inedited documents that we can start with the 19th century, and there is no copyright of living persons. So
I must confess that the work on the letters of Bronisława Waligórska changed my life. The research and queries is the first step, but the great work is the is publishing and transcription and etc. It's a huge challenge.
Karolina,
I have a question first to follow up in the diaspora, but from a different angle. I was wondering, you were talking about the territory of Greater Poland and you were talking about women, but are they all around, are you looking for texts in Polish or are you looking for texts in other languages written by women within the territory of Poland? And this is especially relevant with the question of the Holocaust and survival, not only.
Yes, it is a very big challenge.
Silesia?
Do
you
include
Silesia
into the future?
Yes.
I have a question. Of course, your work is absolutely stunning and I admire you, but I want to ask you about two things. One, have you thought about gathering also text which wasn't written as a text, but they were treated as a documents for sociologists? But against he started, and this is very important. And there is many texts written for some calls. Write me about your life. Write me about your town, about your childhood, and so on. And second question: why you don't search? But maybe you do. I don't know. Women diaries, letters, and other texts autobiographical, which are connected with the First World War. It's absolutely forgotten topic, and it's so much work to do. I'm going to do it.
Eva?
We cooperate with historian from University of Warsaw, Katarzyna Sierakowska. She's a specialist from First War, and we have diaries and letters written by women on the beginning of 20th century. Mm-hmm. Yes, of course, we did. We are our project is total.
We got a collection, and it is a collection which I talk about it. And one moment, yes. We have works which were entered by women in literature historical competitions. And there are many, many diaries, memoirs, letters. about the town, about the country, and how they feel as a, for example, little girl. And yes, we got some part that, and about languages. In our database are mainly are documents in Polish, but not only in Polish. We got also documents. We got records of documents which were written in Russian, in French, in Yiddish. Let me think a little bit.
Lithuanian?
Yes, in Lithuanian, yes. I think it's all. But yes, we want to have another language, of course. As Monika said, we want it to be total.
Yes?
I don't know, I have no problems in Lithuania, but I know Lithuanian, so maybe it's
yes.
easier.
Yes, Emilia is a very important person, she knows Lithuanian.
Yeah, but in National Archive in Vilnius, the catalogs are in Russian, so I know a little bit Russian to read catalogs, only catalogs of manuscripts. I don't experience many problems in this case. Maybe other girls.
I would like to add that, of course, it is difficult, but we try to get know something about this archive before we go there. Then we go there not one time, but often twice or three times and so on. And in our database, we try to collect these remarks on how to deal with this archive. So I think it's important for future researchers that they will find some hints in our database how to find these documents and how to deal with these archives. Okay.
But we are used to take adventure.
Yeah, your question. Yeah.
This is a question about search categories as you're shifting from thinking about the object to the database. And I wondered, because I was trying to, in one of the slides, you had certain kinds of categories of identity that you put down as search categories in a way, class,
yes.
gender, or whatever. But I'm interested in kind of about how you're thinking through a markup that is sensitive to things like sexuality
mm-hmm.
and to some new analytic frameworks people are using, like disability studies, because that's such a complicated thing when you're talking about the search capacities of a database. And I wonder if you've had some interesting conversations about those.
So we may confess that we have our secret database but we decided that because of some, let's say, political reasons, we will not publish it openly. Well, first, because of political reasons, that it is now a very uncomfortable topic in Poland, but from the other side, we think that it is a kind of indiscretion towards these people we are dealing with. And so we have such a database, but we think now that we will be give this data only to the researchers who will really be interested in these specific topics.
Mm-hmm. And the last question?
I don't know if it's a question or just a comment. As you were talking about a total project that is founded on short-time financial supportings and temporary grants. And I was thinking that what you started is, it is a total project. And it is a lifelong project also for you and other generations of researchers. And I really can't wait for the moment when your database will be open. Because I'm really sure that it would change the way we practice feminism critiques in Poland right now, but it would change also other things. It wouldn't be easy to unnotice your autobiographical writings when you do this. So I'm just waiting for the moment.
Thank you for this comment. It is a closing remark. I opening this discussion, I suppose that this messianic element of Monika's speech will provoke the most of comments and discussion, but it was quiet. I announced the coffee break. We meet together at 1:15.